Hello, here we are in beautiful Baja, Tustin, at the McNeil International Film Headquarters, and today we're going to talk about the equation of exchange and whether it's useful for policy or not. So the first thing is, the equation of exchange is an identity. It is true by definition. It must be true because it's an identity. We'll do that. And there are four terms. MV equals PQ, or PY sometimes. But the money supply times the velocity of circulation of money is equal to the price level times the real quantity of goods produced in the economy. Velocity of circulation of money is the number of times that a dollar is spent and re-spent in a year on a final good or service. If you want to think of it as the number of trips around the circular flow that a dollar takes, great. And Q is real GDP, but if you were to take real GDP, this year's GDP, in real terms, and multiply it by the price level, you get nominal GDP. So P times Q is nominal GDP. Now, every year they publish what is real GDP, what is the price level, and they publish the money supply. So, if, for instance, the money supply, and we have to define it as M1 or M2 or MZM, but let's say the money supply is 150 and velocity is 4, the price level that is published is 2, what that means is that real GDP must be 300, because 150 times 4 must equal 2 times 300. It's true by definition, it's an identity. So that's the equation of exchange. The question is whether or not this can be used as a policy tool when talking about monetary policy. And so we have to make the first assumption, and that is, if velocity is constant, velocity is the inverse of money demand. When money demand goes up, velocity of circulation goes down. When money demand goes down, velocity of circulation goes up. So if you think of, if people want to hold less money, for instance, during the Weimar Republic in Germany, the horrific hyperinflation then, when wives would come to the factory gates to collect the money, workers would be paid 2 or 3 times a day. And wives would come to the factory gates and take the money and then go spend it immediately before it lost its value because of the hyperinflation. Well, in that situation, the money demand was zero, or as close to zero as they could get. So anytime they got money, they immediately spent it. And so because it went from hand to hand so rapidly, the velocity of circulation was enormous. So the point is that when money demand goes down, velocity goes up. When people are content to hold their money instead of spending it and circulating it, then the velocity of circulation goes down. They're just inverse to each other. Okay, let's change this. MV equals peak, money times velocity equals price times the real GDP or real quantity. And change it to rates of change. The rate of change of the money supply plus the rate of change of velocity must equal the rate of change of the price level times the rate of change of real GDP. So, let's say if velocity is constant, then the rate of change of velocity is zero. It's constant. That means that the rate of change of the money supply will show up in nominal GDP. So that if the money supply grows at 4% per year, nominal GDP must grow at 4% per year. But when it comes to nominal GDP, it could be either the price level that's growing 4% and quantity is not changing, or it could be that quantity grows 4% and price doesn't change. Or it could be 2 and 2. It doesn't matter. It could be some proportion. But the point is that it's changing nominal GDP, not necessarily real GDP. And if you're going to talk about how monetary policy should be conducted, the money supply should grow, and its effect does, ideally would be on the quantity. You want quantity increases, not price level increases. So is there a way to figure this out? And the answer we can start looking for this issue, is the quantity, is quantity growth constrained by real factors? Well, when we talk about economic growth, we have to have more resources, better technology, and improvement in rules of the game in order to get real growth. And real growth, in the long run, increases in the United States historically at somewhere between 3 and 4%. So, if we have money growth of, say, 4%, and the quantity grows at 4%, then we should expect that the price level will remain constant. But what if money supply grows at 14%? Then 4% of that increase in the money supply will be soaked up by quantity growth, and the other 10 must be in price level changes. So this is Uncle Miltie Friedman, of course, to use Uncle Miltie's monetary rule, where basically he assumed that for policy purposes and over the long run, velocity was relatively constant, and that you could treat it as a constant for policy purposes. And if it was your desire to have no growth in prices, that is, not have inflation, then Uncle Miltie said that, and if quantity is constrained to grow at 4% per year, then what should the money supply grow at? And the answer is, of course, 4%, that the money supply should grow at roughly the same rate as the growth of real GDP in the economy in order to have non-inflationary growth. And Uncle Miltie said, if this is the case, the implication, of course, is that the entire Federal Reserve monetary policy apparatus, all of the people involved and so forth, could be replaced by a well-programmed computer. Now, you can imagine how the people at the Fed feel about this. Do they agree? Well, no, there's plenty of evidence to suggest that velocity is not constant. The question is whether it's constant enough. And in the long run, more, it appears, maybe yes, constant, or at least for policy purposes. Whereas in the short run, velocity bounces around. So that if, for instance, the Federal Reserve, to try and stimulate the economy, increases the money supply by 10%, but if velocity is decreasing, then there's a good chance that this increase in the money supply could be offset by the velocity decreases, and that there could be little or no change on the other side in terms of nominal GDP. Conversely, when the money supply gets going, if the price level starts to rise, money demand starts to go down like it did in the Weimar Republic, and all of a sudden velocity starts increasing tremendously, causing enormous increases in nominal GDP. Sadly, the hyperinflation causes price levels to rise very rapidly, but real output just doesn't. Anyway, as a first approximation, it's always interesting to look at Uncle Miltie's monetary rule in terms of the numbers and see how fast the money supply is growing, and then ask, is there a justification for changing the money supply to be much different from what the real GDP growth would be? Anyway, this is the equation of exchange and its usefulness for monetary policy, Uncle Miltie's monetary rule, and the issue of whether velocity is constant. That's it. Out.